after the barbecue. We are excited today to have the woman you know as JR's right-hand woman, Sly, Deborah Rennard, on, along with our first, this is a first, non-Dallas cast member, Al Sapienza, whom you might know from The Sopranos, House of Cards, Dirty Dancing, the stage version. 24, you were on Suits, Reacher, which my mother has been watching obsessively lately, so she's probably seen you. You popped up on Bates Motel at one point, Wilfred, The Blacklist, and Designated Survivor, among other things, and 24. So you worked with Kiefer Sutherland twice, I guess.
And I worked on Bates Motel, I worked with Rihanna.
With who was it, Rihanna? Oh, that's right. She was.
She showed up. You know, it's a guest star on a TV episode. She showed up with an entourage of 16 people. And we're shooting like two scenes. You know, it was pretty funny. we recreated from the original movie, the Hitchcock movie, the scene where she meets with all the business people. And then she steals the money and has it in a briefcase. We recreated that whole same scene.
I remember that scene.
Those businessmen that was hitting on it.
And you had who was the woman that played Norman's mother
in the movie or the TV show?
TV show, yeah.
Babby's Mia Famiglia.
She reminds me of Felicity Huffman from Desperate Housewives.
Yes, they are very much alike. I remind them of Pee-wee Herman all the time too.
I worked with him before he was Pee Wee Herman. I worked with him when he was just Paul Rubens.
Really?
Okay. Yeah, in a show. It was destined for Broadway. It fortunately didn't make it, but we did a ton of backers auditions, and he played the villain.
And, of course.
It was many years ago, because I think I was only like 20 years old at the time.
He had Morgan Fairchild in the movie who originated the role of Jenna Wade.
Right. That's right.
They should get Morgan there and then have Patrick with Morgan and Priscilla in a photo op. You were on 186 episodes thereabouts. JR returns.
Yep.
Due South, Silk Stockings, Days of Our Lives, which is, I think you mentioned in the past that you were in the dressing room when you found out Dallas was canceled.
What a memory you have.
Oh, yeah. Good. Patrick calls me the show historian.
Yes, you are. My God. So it was kind of a sad situation because the season ended, 13, and the network was hinting that they might not pick it up, but they didn't say definitely. So we went to the wrap party and we saw everybody, and it wasn't like a final, wow, this was great, goodbye. It was just sort of a, well, we'll see what happens. And then everybody found out like individually on their own. And then there was no gathering where we could all kind of have closure. It was really sad. I was sitting in the dressing room at NBC Burbank, and I got a phone call. It was Leonard Katzman that he called me personally. And he said, yeah, sorry to say we didn't get picked up. And, you know, it was a great run and everything. And I was like, oh. And that was the last time I saw many, many people for a long time. We did the movie. Yeah, that's true. We did the movie.
Which last scene, you're drunk in your bathtub calling Sue Ellen. And
a la Sue Ellen, because she was always getting drunk, right?
Right.
Trying to deal with JR.
This is JR's assistant.
She's turned into Sue Ellen. Now she's going to be sloshed. But it was so nice to see everybody, and especially Larry, because that was after he'd had the operation where he had the kidney transplant and stuff. And so.
And then you saw them in 2008 when we all met at that fan source dinner for the first time.
You have the best memory. And I didn't see them at all in between that time. And I was.
And that was the first time Larry and Linda had seen Omri Katz. And we pulled that practical joke on them at that dinner with the empty seat between them. And then Christopher Atkins introduced him. And it's an honor when you can prank Larry and
absolutely, because that's what they were total pranksters. I tell everybody, you know, there was never a serious rehearsal in the 10 years I was on that show. Leonard, we would do some kind of rehearsal, and Patrick and Larry would be, you know, goofing off, and finally Leonard would just say, okay, let's just shoot this thing, you know. But I think it was because by the time I got on the show, you know, it was end of season 3, beginning of season 4. It was a hit show. It was the number one show. Everybody knew what they had to do. So they didn't even need a rehearsal. Like, they just, you know, so it was great.
And, Kept and Al was the Sopranos more serious?
What?
Was the rehearsals more serious?
No.
No?
I mean, when you actually got to like the rehearsal right before shooting, the Sopranos, it was, in those days, there was no work in New York City. There was one Dick Wolf show. It was all unknown actors.
Now, every show is a Dick Wolf show.
And, you know, Lorraine Bracco was the only famous person. She hadn't worked in a while. Jimmy was only on Get Shorty and
Practice, right?
No, he the what?
Oh, no, you're thinking of the other...
Jimmy Gandolfini.
Gandolfini, yeah.
Yeah, he was only on Get Shorty and Crimson Tide. Nobody knew him. No, it was all unknown actors. Everybody. So we were so happy to have a job. It was a it was just a celebration. And it was just, it was great.
In the later seasons, and it was just, you also did Lionheart, and then.
Did. And that's become a cult hit. It's amazing.
Took a break for a while. You've come back with Law & Order, FBI Most Wanted, East New York, and The Family's Feud. So you're back in the scene again after.
Scene, yeah. I became a producer. I went to the other side. I got married and my husband was a filmmaker and I had always been interested in what everybody else is doing while I'm sitting in my chair. And so I became head of his development and I read all the scripts, hired the staff writers, you know, helped with editing and casting. And I loved it. You know, he won Oscars while we were together and it was interesting and it was creative. And I did it because we had a son together and I wanted to be there for my son and I wanted to do something I could do kind of on my own schedule. I didn't want to be sitting waiting in a trailer all day long while my son was growing up without me. So that's what I did. And then when my son was grown up and my husband and I actually separated and then Al and I met, we started singing together and then people were like, "Wow, you guys are amazing." And they'd look at me and they'd say, "What are you acting in now?" And I was like, I'm not really acting anymore. And they're all like, "Well, why not?" So, okay. So went back to acting.
And I see it online a few times. People actually have said, "Oh, Deb and her husband, Al." And I'm going, "No, they're not married."
I know.
They're not married.
We perform so much together. People see us together so much. It's true. It's true. Now, sometimes they refer to me as his wife.
We should be married.
Stage wife, stage husband.
That's right. That's right.
Right. Yeah. I remember meeting Paul back in 2008 at the dinner.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, he wanted to take the photo of us. And I said, "No, Paul, get in the photo for crying out loud."
That's so funny. Yeah, that's so Paul.
Yeah. So actually, we're not talking about Dallas today because it's after the barbecue. So it's after the show. And we're actually really talking about your musical careers together and let me see if this works. I'm just going to play a little bit of what you sent me, so bear with me for a second here. Let's do this.
That was fun.
And Al, I have to say, when I heard you doing Neil Diamond, you sound just like Neil Diamond.
I'm lip syncing. Spent a lot of my whole family's from Brooklyn. I kind of have that same baritone voice. I've got the same accent as his. So it just kind of comes out. It's amazing. I do sound like Neil Diamond.
And he's now sung Sweet Caroline as many times as we sing it everywhere. People love that song.
Can you come to Fenway Park and do it in the eighth inning?
Love it. My Yankee friends would kill me, but I'll do it.
Neil showed up after the marathon bombing the following weekend. This is when David Ortiz gave his famous speech where he said, "This is not our effing city." Mm-hmm. And Neil Diamond sang Sweet Caroline in the eighth inning at the game.
Oh my God, they must have.
He flew overnight just to do that. But,
I love him. I loved him from the day in 1968 when I used to stay up all night with Tony Orlando's son, John. And John would play the drums in Tony Orlando's private soundproof studio. And John would play the drums, I'd play the guitar, and we'd sing Neil Diamond all night. He was like 13 years old, and I was like 25. You know, I love that kid. We're still super good friends to this day. Deb and I were on his podcast in Las Vegas recently. It's actually a show.
Yeah. Didn't he just announce his final tour? Is he on his farewell tour?
Yeah. He said that. Yeah, we just saw him at the New Jersey Hall of Fame. It was giving him a special award, and we were there talking with him for a long time. And he said,
"Here's a surprise that they added." And I always laugh when I hear this name, like when I hear Dick Butkus's name. Engelbert Humperdinck is going to be at the show.
Yeah,
really?
He had a great voice. I guess he has a great voice.
Yeah. So.
That's great.
How long have you both been singing? Not together, but just in general over the years.
Well, I've been singing since high school. That's kind of where I fell in love with musicals and discovered I had a good voice, and was encouraged to sing more. And I actually, it was my dream to go to Broadway, and then I got Dallas. Dallas is the reason I didn't go to Broadway, because it was the number one show. And I'm like, oh my God, what do? I can't go to New York and be a starving actor and try to make it in theater, although it's my dream, or be on the number one show in television. So I chose the number one show in television, not thinking it was going to go on for a decade more. And, you know, I couldn't leave. So then by the time it was over, I was like, oh, I wanted to get married, have a kid, you know. So it was interesting that when my husband and I separated in 2010, and I decided I was going to fulfill my dream, I'm going to come to New York and work in theater. And that's when I reconnected with Al. And he started, you know, taking me to these charity events and saying, let's sing. And people afterwards were always like, wow, where's your show? Where do we see you more? And we don't have one. Maybe we should create one. And that's how it came about. We just decided we got to create a show. So we did. And now it just gets bigger and bigger. You know, we sing in Vegas. We sing in L.A. at Herb Alpert's place, Vibrato Grill. We sing internationally. We just got back from the Philippines. We sang in June in Italy. I mean, it just keeps getting bigger.
You know, and I'm not just saying this because I'm her fan and her partner. If she had gone to Broadway, if you see our show and you see her sing and dance and sing Les Mis and West Side Story, and she would have blown away Christine Baranski, Sutton Foster, Stocker Channing. I'm telling you, with her looks and the way she sings and dances, she would have killed in New York theater. But, you know,
high praise there, Deb.
What's that?
Yeah. High praise, yes.
It's totally true. Yeah. You'll know when you see her. I mean, she would have been the leading lady, you know, because she sings and dances that well and also looks the way she looks. It would have been really interesting. But
I keep trying to get down to a show, but it's just scheduling.
Oh, gosh. Can you come on February 10th at the Cutting Room?
You're
in Boston, right?
I'm in Boston, yeah. I actually had lunch with Deb once when she came up to Boston for something. But
Deb Trinelli, yeah. Oh, please try. We would love to have you there.
I'll try. It's just a matter of paying for the whole California trip coming up too. That's kind of getting in the way too. So
true. And you know what? We're performing at Herb Alpert's place in LA on March 21st. So if it was just closer to March 1st and 2nd for that Hollywood show, we could keep you there and you could come see us there.
Well, do they have a ballroom? You two can get up and sing for everybody.
You know what? We're singing at the event I've told you about. We're doing one at Happy Valley Comic Con at the end of February in Pennsylvania. We didn't ask. We should ask.
We should.
Maybe we should. Yes. I don't know if they have one.
Al, talking about your singing, when did you start? Is it from childhood? Or?
I was the youngest of five children. So the minute I was born, there were albums, rock and roll albums, Murray the K albums, Alan Freed albums all over the house. I started singing when I was a little kid, like 4 or 5 years old. I would sit on my rocking horse. I had a red rocking horse. And I'd sing Bobby Vinton. And the first time I sang for people was in fifth grade. I had a rock and roll band. And we sang I'm a Believer by the Monkees. And wound up doing, all the girls were going, Ruby Tuesday, Ruby Tuesday. The other three guys in the band, I didn't know what the hell they were talking about. But so they played Ruby Tuesday and I just faked it. So that was my first performance. Then to make money when I was in college, I played the drums since the Beatles came February. I saw the Ed Sullivan Show.
50 years ago.
Yeah, 60.
That's right. They just had that.
60 years.
The anniversary is going to be the day before our show, right?
February 9th. And My father bought me a gold snare drum and one cymbal. I begged him, and I started playing the drums when I was 8. And then he bought me a full drum set for my confirmation, a pearl drum set. And I started playing, and I wound up in a Broadway show 4 months out of graduating from NYU, Beatlemania. We played the Beatles. And if you didn't see it, it sounds ridiculous. It was a smash hit. It was fabulous. It was fabulous. It was the grandfather to Jersey Boys. We were the first jukebox musical, and it was the Beatles, you know. And people thought we were lip syncing. That's how long they rehearsed. It was at the Winter Garden. And, you know, it was a major show, special effects lights. So I was in that for 5 years and singing. But while I was in college, to make money, I played the drums for every singer on Christopher Street in Greenwich Village. It was insane, let me tell you. And then, you know, I just love it. Singing is like, it just puts you in a, it's like getting high without any of the bad side effects when you're singing. And singing with her, it's, you know, it's fabulous.
We just have such a great time.
I met her in 1984 in acting class.
That was my next question. Where'd you meet? How'd you meet?
I met her in class. She was 24 years old. She was just adorable. And we met in class, and we were in class for, I was in that class for 14 years. She was in it for 6 years. And then getting together once our teacher died, we met at his memorial. And then she moved to New York, and I was like, come sing, come to karaoke with me. These have these private rooms where you practice singing, you know, them. And I was like, oh my God, you're amazing. Like literally, I was like, I couldn't believe her voice. You'll see. And then I was always invited to these charities for the Sopranos, and I would always sing one or two songs. So I brought her, would sing All I Ask of You from Phantom, and people would go nuts. They really would go nuts because her voice is, she's a perfect soprano, always on pitch. So then we started the show, and the show's like, it's like a one-man show, but a two-man show. It's an autobiographical journey of our lives through music. We do a lot of speaking. We wrote the book ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it's much more than us just singing. It's about the 60s and 70s. We have films, videos, and it's about how these songs affected our careers and lives. Up to this point in this interview, for the first time, I understood what Kamala Harris' husband feels like.
Yeah, hardly. We basically took all our favorite songs and songs that have moved us and affected us throughout our lives, and we figured out how to turn it into a show. And it's super fun, and people come and they're amazed, and they love it. And afterwards, the one comment we hear more than anything is people coming up to us and saying, I can't remember the last time I had so much fun.
And how good looking I am.
Well, that goes without saying, Al. But anyway, yeah, it's super fun, and it's great. And we have such an eclectic mix of music, too. I think a lot of times when you go to these kinds of cabaret type shows, it's one genre. You know, it's all Cole Porter, it's all Gershwin, it's all whatever. Right. And we just mix it up so much that it just goes boom, boom, boom. You know, we're singing Frank Sinatra, Beatles, Neil Diamond, Barbara Streisand, Best of Broadway, you know, Simon and Garfunkel, Billy Joel, I mean, Supremes, Gordon Lightfoot. It's just like, whoa, you know.
Billy Joel is actually releasing his first single on February 1st in how many decades?
Wow.
Do you consider yourselves, I know Meatloaf always talked about how he said, I'm a performer that sings. Do you consider yourselves actors that sing or singers that act?
It's a good question. I consider myself a moron that just does all of this for fun.
I think when I'm acting, I just think that I'm an actor. And when I'm on a stage and I'm singing, I'm a performer because it's a different kind of energy, you know, that you're giving to the audience than when you're in front of a camera. And I just feel like it's two different things, but I love them both. So I feel so fortunate that I get to do both.
I think of myself as an actor who sings, like, in, you know, but singing is, if you're singing well, you're totally acting. You're communicating the song more than worried about what you sound like. And you're just communicating the lyrics of the song. I love it. It's just so much fun. And we wouldn't, like, we're sitting here telling you how good the show is. It's kind of ridiculous, but we wouldn't.
Just toot the horn.
But we wouldn't be doing this show. It's been 7 years if it wasn't good.
Oh,
because it's just, we sell out every time. It's word of mouth. And it's and we're, it's not that we're good. The show's good. The selection, the songs are all number one, you know, timeless hits. And when people hear it, they're like, I remember I kissed my first girl when that song was playing in 1968, you know, in the woods. And that's what it does to people. It just, it's so nostalgic. And we don't sing the songs to put our stamp on them. Nobody cares about Al Sapienza's vision of She Loves You. We reproduce those songs so you're like listening to the record. That's what we try to do.
As close as possible to the original recording that everybody remembers and loves.
Yeah.
You know? And so, we sang for, we opened for Peter Noon of Herman's Hermits for 8,000.
That's right.
That's right. So,
see, can I tell a funny story?
Yeah, yeah.
I don't mean to dominate your Dallas.
Yeah, you always do.
Yeah, I can't help it. It's just my personality.
It is your personality.
So we're opening for Peter Noon and the Tokens. The Tokens, the lion sleeps tonight. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So Peter Noon is walking around and he didn't hear us sing yet, and he's making fun of us. And he's harassing Deborah. He goes, "You're opening a rock and roll show with 'You Don't Bring Me Flowers' by Barbra Streisand."
Well, it wasn't really harassing, but he was kind of joking. He basically came up to me and said, "You know, I've always seen a show. I've always wanted to see a show where people open with 'You Don't Bring Me Flowers.'"
Right.
You know, and it was a little bit like that's a pretty interesting way to open a show.
Nobody
opens a show with a ballad. They open a show with a big, you know, number to engage the audience or whatever. But we decided to go a whole nother direction. And we pull the audience in by doing a song that was just completely intimate, singing to each other. And they really are like, what am I seeing? This is different. And that's what we want. And then we go into Sweet Caroline and all this other stuff. But it was funny. He came up to me and said that, you know, and I was like, yeah, okay, well.
It's like Paul McCartney opening with Yesterday. Like it's a very sad song. They don't know how to say goodbye. So he comes to my side of the stage because we enter this thing and we sing to each other. We don't even look at the audience in this song. It's totally dramatic. It's like being
it's like
in a
theater.
Play. It's like theater. So he was like, he goes, you know, he starts talking to me and he didn't know who I was. And he goes, how do you fit? And I said, well, I'm part of the staff. He goes, oh, you're the other one that's opening up. This is his rock show. And he's afraid of the audience. After we did the thing, like the audience was roaring.
They went crazy.
He was like, wow, that was something.
And he was stunned. He couldn't believe it.
Yeah, he couldn't believe it.
He came backstage. He was like, wow, you guys are great. You know, it was really nice.
And that's not the first time that Herman's Hermits has had a interesting combination, because they toured with The Who at one
point
back in the 60s, which is odd. It was like it's like Jimi Hendrix with the Monkees.
right. Interesting combination. Yeah.
But Peter is great.
He's wonderful.
Peter is a great entertainer, incredibly funny and witty, like shockingly so.
Yeah.
And he sounds fabulous. His show is, listen, he was great. The guy was great. He knows how to do this.
Yeah. He's got a great voice, a great personality. He still looks great. And he could have been just a comedian. He's so funny.
Yeah,
he could just do a show where he's just telling jokes.
And he has the audience. Like, I'm talking about Johnny Carson witty.
Yeah.
I was shocked. He has them hysterically laughing. Like, he could be a stand-up comic.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, I did not know that, Ed. No.
Yes.
But there are a lot of actors out there that think they can sing, but they can't and they shouldn't. And thankfully, we have two here that can sing and do sing and are doing a great job at it. Did you have formal training at all, or?
I did. I studied. I was in all the choirs, of course, in school. And then, and actually my high school choir teacher approached me one day and said, do you want to study opera? And I was like, my stepfather sang opera as a hobby. I'm like, I don't know. And she said, because you have the capability of singing opera and they're looking for some people, you know, to submit for a scholarship or whatever. And if you're interested, I'll submit you. And I thought about it and I thought, no, my heart is musical theater. I'm not interested in singing opera, but I have that quality. And sometimes people come up. Oh, just the other night, we were doing a show for at a pub in Queens for Kelsey Grammer. And we sang All I Ask of You. And same thing. People came up to me and said, do you sing opera? Because I have that quality to my voice. But then I can also sing, you know, cabaret and Don't Rain on My Parade and, you know, contemporary, you know, You Don't Bring Me Flowers. And, you know, so.
So
So I have formal training. I was always in chorus in junior high school and high school. And then once I got in Beatlemania, they had singing coaches for us all. Again, we had to, but I mean, I'm a good singer. I'm a good singer, but she's off the charts.
You sell yourself short. You got that Neil Diamond thing going. So
that's right. Out of high school, I studied with probably, 10 different singing teachers privately for at least like 10 or 12 years. I studied with the woman who taught Bernadette Peters. I studied with the guy who worked with Michael Jackson and Madonna and all these people. I studied with a lot of different teachers. So I had a lot of different vocal training.
I studied in LA with Joni Sajak, and she fixed me up on a blind date with Cybill Shepherd.
Huh. Okay.
That's a true story.
So you were with Kelsey Grammer. When are you going to be on Frasier? No.
Doing a movie with this production company that's a new production company, and they were having an event, and they knew us and loved us and said, come sing, And now they want us to sing for... They approached us to sing at the 9/11 event.
Yeah, the 9/11
next event. This year, 2024.
What is it, the 50th?
Oh, God, it's 2024, right? That's hard to believe.
I know. 2024.
So you've been talking about the show and some of the artists and some of the inspiration. So what can fans expect when they come to the show?
People feel like they've just come to a wonderful party. It's a celebration of life and music, and they're moved by the ballads, and they sing along, and and they laugh, and I think it's a wonderful sort of immersive experience, because I think our show reaches out to people so much. I talk in the beginning of the show about the power of music and how Al thought of this, but I say it in the show about how, if you watch a movie, it's a few hours, or a book, it's several days to read, but a song in just 3 minutes can transport you to a whole nother world. And that's what it does for us. And I also think that music has the power to heal us. It connects to our soul. And that's what I think people feel when they're at our show.
Yeah. Everyone says it makes, I know it sounds like we're plugging our own show, it just sounds terrible, but it's not that. Because of the material we picked, every song is a number one hit. So, when Paul McCartney sings his new songs, it's Paul McCartney. He's the best thing on earth. Nobody cares. When most bands come and sing their new albums, nobody cares. And it's the best musicians in the world. But when they play, the Eagles play in Hotel California and Take It Easy, people are, so all our show, our whole show are those hits. At the end, people are on their feet, dancing to Twist and Shout, screaming, yelling. And then when we're done, all they tell us is, this was the most fun night we had in years. It's more entertaining than most Broadway shows. I'm telling you, it's just people have fun. They love the music. Time. That's it. We put them in a good mood. That's it.
I think when you were talking about other artists performing new material, Elton John always would say, okay, now it's time for the bathroom break for everybody.
I'm going to do the new stuff.
Because it's true. You go because of the hits that you know and you love. And then sometimes there'll be a new song. You'd be like, oh, yeah, that's interesting, whatever. But you're just waiting for the next big hit. So right. We just thought, let's just sing all hits.
And what? When there's a hit, like when Elton John has the bathroom break, but then if he sang, Someone Saved My Life last night, everyone, it's a hit.
Oh, yeah.
It's a hit. It's the, when you think about it, you can't define what makes a hit. A hit is a hit because it's a hit. It just affects people in a positive way. So when you play all hits, like we did a show, I don't want to mention any names, not too long ago, and this artist was a phenomenal singer, and he was a phenomenal guitar player, and he played all his original music. People were like kind of half asleep. But then when he only played two hits from other artists, they were thrilled. A hit is a hit because it's just a hit. And it makes people happy. It releases endorphins in their brain. So, if you're going to play all hits and you play them right, no matter what, who's singing it, the show's going to be good.
Yeah. And we have an amazing musical director. His name's Joey Malotti. He has worked with Barry Manilow. He still works with him for 25 years as his musical director and keyboard player. He also, before that, he worked with Liza Minnelli. He worked with Michael Bolton. He is the top. He lives in Las Vegas. We fly him in. He puts together a band for us, top musicians, the Broadway musicians, the Saturday Night Live musicians. And they're amazing. They're amazing. The sound is fantastic.
Yeah. Get well soon, Michael Bolton. You just had that surgery.
Isn't that sad? Oh my God.
I watched him on the Disney Christmas parade performing at the end, and he didn't look, he sounded incredible, but he did not look right. And
interesting.
Now and he's had that surgery.
He already known about his diagnosis at that time, do you think?
That parade's recorded at the beginning of November, so he might have.
Maybe he didn't even know yet, but he was feeling
right,
something.
But seeing it. Yeah. Thankfully he's had, and he's hopefully on the mend and all that.
Yeah,
but,
I hope so. I know.
Yeah. And you talk about not performing hits. Reminded me that Elton John, when he did this last tour, he said, "I'm not going to stop performing, but I may just do a residency and not play my hits and just play what I want to play now." And that's where the diehard fans will show up for something
right,
like that.
But, right.
You took.
I mean, how many times have they sung these songs? They creative. They have to have something new, you know. So of course they want to have new material,
right?
But it's hard because even someone at that level, every song isn't a hit.
And I think he just recorded an album with Brandi Carlile, so that should be out this year. So you talked about the Philippines. How did that come up? Going to the Philippines of all places,
I went high school, buddy. Was an officer in the Navy, and then he was in Naval Intelligence. He married an oncologist from Sloan Kettering in Manhattan. She's from the Philippines. Her grandfather founded a university in 1948. So her father took it over. When her father died, she was an MD at Sloan Kettering. She felt obligated to go take over the college. So they called us up and go, "Would you perform on our 75th anniversary?" And we were like, yeah, you know, so they flew us out in flatbeds.
Watch the Philippines. Never been there.
It was great. and it was really an adventure. And then they had us come back again for Christmas and New Year's and everything. And we played for some politicians. We played at this crazy resort. It was really fun. And it was an adventure.
But for the 75th anniversary, we were playing for 16,000 people. We'd never played for a crowd that size, you know?
Wow.
It was amazing.
And I went out and I shook every one of their hands.
Have you thought of recording an album together or putting out a soundtrack?
And we just never make it happen. And we really do have to make it happen because Joey Malotti has his own studio. So it's like,
Joey, you got to get him in there.
Joey, like, come on. And he was like, let's go. And it's just somehow between the singing engagements and the acting and life, we just haven't made it happen. We really do have to.
And we need a hit or two. We need an original hit. People have been sending us songs. So if we're going to record an original song, it's got to be a great song.
Just record our covers. Yeah,
maybe Sweet Caroline. But why would anybody want to hear a record of me? It's one thing seeing me in person. I have stage presence. But listen to Neil Diamond if you're going to listen to the record of Sweet Caroline. Why listen to me?
He's an expert on Beatle trivia because he was in the show and they studied it for such a long time. But how many years were they rehearsing and other people's music before they started their own songs?
The Beatles rehearsed every day unless one of them was sick with the flu. From 1956 on, they played two performances at the Cavern Club. They did Little Richard. They did Elvis. They didn't record an original tune till the first record they ever recorded was "My Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean." It wasn't theirs on the Rory Storm and the Hurricanes album. They didn't record their first original till New Year's Day, 1962. That's when they recorded, I think it was "All My Love and Her Please Please Me." I can't believe I don't remember, but.
So you have a couple upcoming shows that we should bring up. You have Best Valentine Date Night at the Cutting Room in New York on February 10th. That's 44 East 32nd Street. And the Cutting Room NYC.com is for information. What's the show going to be like that night? Obviously a Valentine's theme.
Yeah, well, no, we sing the same show.
Same show. It's just that our show is a great Valentine's Day night because it has so many love songs.
Saturday night of Valentine's Day week, and we do the whole show. We did it last year, and it's a sellout.
We always
sell. We're almost sold out now.
Yeah, bunch of his Sopranos friends are coming.
Yeah, a bunch of Stevie Van Zandt, Maureen's
little Stephen.
Little Stephen may make it this time.
Oh,
but
wow.
You know what he said to me? He said that for his garage TV station on Sirius, he said it's February 9th is going to be a gigantic day. So he's probably going to have to do stuff because it's the 60th anniversary when the Beatles were on Ed Sullivan. And then we play the 10th. So, but Maureen Van Zandt's definitely going to come from The Sopranos. Who else is coming? Jeff Bricchetti is definitely coming.
And then you're in Los Angeles on the 21st of March at Herb Albert's Vibratos, 2930. I can't even read my writing there. Oh, Beverly Glen Circle, vibratogrilljazz.com. We'll get that all up on our show notes too.
Thank you, yeah.
You also have, we talked about before we went on, have been getting into the fan celebrity show meet and greets, and I know you've done, Deb, you were doing a couple in New Jersey at one point.
I did. My first one was last year in New Jersey. It was a smaller one. I don't remember what that one was called.
I don't either. That was fun.
Then we did the Hollywood show last year, which I think was July. And then we did Chiller in the fall. And now we're going to be doing the Hollywood show, which is where we're going to see you and all the other Dallas cast on March 1st and 2nd.
There are, last I counted, 26 Dallas cast members.
Wow.
And our honorary cast member now, Al.
Exactly. Oh, we're also doing, just because you're the Dallas fans, Deborah Trinelli and I will be at the Happy Valley Comic-Con on February 24th and 25th. That's in Pennsylvania. So that's another one for Dallas fans.
You have to put that one in an email so I can put it up there, because whenever we record at the beginning of the show, we do birthdays, death anniversaries, thank our Patreons, and also just different upcoming appearances for things. And so we'll put that up. But 26 cast members, and then three people who had cameo appearances on the show. We have Robert Pine, who played Jenna Wade's psychiatrist during the dream season.
He's a friend of mine.
Really?
Robert's a friend of mine.
He was supposed to be part of a Chips reunion, but Larry Wilcox and Eric Estrada had to cancel at the Hollywood show. So Kim Johnston Ulrich, who was in the Conundrum episode, the series finale, is going to be there. And then an actor, Stephen Williams, played the bailiff during Ray's manslaughter trial, somebody pointed out. So that really is like 29 if you're a fanatic and you're looking for every person that ever appeared on there. But
speaking of that, Josh, and because you are the king of trivia, how, I'm going to ask you a question. I'll be shocked if you know the answer, but how many cast members total are there for the 13 years Dallas was on the air?
Got to count it on IMDb Pro. And the answer will be,
I'm going to go to my safety answer for now because no one's ever asked that question. I'll just say X. and then the show came back, so you have we tried to get you for JR's funeral to get asked.
Totally wanted to do that. You know, I like I said, I'd gone off and been doing producing and writing, and but they tracked me down through my very first agent who booked me on Dallas, you know, at the age of 20. And they asked me if I was interested, and I said, absolutely. I haven't acted in a long time, but I absolutely want to be there, of course. And we kind of went back and forth with negotiations. And then in the end, they said, you know what? We're so sorry. We have so many different storylines. We have so many characters. Sly got the axe, and that was really disappointing for me.
And they brought in Kathy Podwell and Deborah Shelton.
Right, right. And a lot of fans wrote me, and they were very disappointed. They're like, you know what? You were with him for 10 years. You were his loyal secretary, always there by his side. We can't believe you weren't there at his funeral. They were very upset.
Until JR returns when he told you you better walk into the Pacific Ocean.
That's right.
But, anything else you want to just...
I can't imagine what else there is to say.
You have to save some for when you're with Deb and Denon, which we're going to be recording.
Oh, that's true. All right. 15th. I'll have to try.
That'll be more Dallas oriented than this. Yeah. This, we just wanted to talk about music and.
We'll think of some office stories. Like Deborah and I would always joke, you know, what they would do is they'd bring us in like right before lunch, put us in these big curlers and then break for lunch. And we'd have to go to the commissary and dress in these big rollers. It was so embarrassing.
For any other upcoming projects, Al, Deb?
Yes, I'm on NCIS on CBS, like right now. I'll be in the season opener on February 12th, 2 days after, 11th or 12th, 2 days or 1 day after.
You got a busy month coming up here.
Yeah,
he works a lot.
NCIS. And Reacher, I highly recommend Reacher. And not because I'm on it. I love that show. I love that show. And I love Alan Rickman. He's amazing and he's nice and humble and grateful. He's a really good guy in real life, too, and that makes it even better.
He doesn't mean Alan Rickman. No, Alan Rickman unfortunately passed away.
Alan Rickman was in the Harry Potter movies.
Right, yeah.
No, it's Alan Rickman, but he's a great guy. Yeah. Anyway, you'll love the show.
And I have a movie that I did last year. It's on Hulu called Appendage. It's a horror thriller. More a psychological thriller. And then the movie I just did down in Baton Rouge, I don't know when that's coming out. It's called Hate Thyself. I play a psychiatrist.
I know we're going to have a big contingent out at the Hollywood show. All four of the podcast hosts are going to be there, so you'll meet all of us in person.
We've already met them.
But,
that's awesome.
Thanks to everyone for joining us today. Thanks, Deb, Al.
Thank you so much, Josh. This was great.
New York City, born and raised. Nowadays I'm lost between two shores. LA's fine, but it ain't home. New York's home, but it ain't mine no more. I am myself.
this way, and I've got to say that I just don't get it. I don't know where we went wrong, but the feeling's gone, and I just can't get it back.
Lead us to a place, guide us with your grace, give us faith so we'll be saved.
He says, Bill, I believe this is killing me, as the smile ran away from his face. Well, I'm sure that I can be a movie star if I can get out of this place.
Anything like this. The sound was so original. And they were charming and funny and witty. And these musicians, four musicians, brought the optimism back into the country.
You know it's up to you. I think it's only fair. Writing her to you. Apologize to her.
He's a real nowhere man. Sitting